25. I'm going to read verses 1 to 10. I'm going to read kind of quick so we can get to the message. And I want you to listen quick. If I read quick, will you listen quick? And, we're going to talk about something here that to me is one of the most important things that church members should know. A lot of people go to church and they're religious. And they attend church regularly. And they believe that they're okay spiritually. But Jesus is telling us something here that we need to take heed to inside the church, the body of Christ, if you will. There are two foundations sitting here today of people that's in this church. Now, I hope, I pray, that everyone in here today is a true born-again Christian. I hope you are. But if you're not, there is absolutely no shame in getting saved today at the end of this message.
Amen.
Realize that first, because everybody here is for you.
Amen.
And that's what they want. They have built a church. They have put their resources together. They have attendance here. They have a church simply for people to get saved.
Amen.
That's the purpose of everything here. So when you hear the message today, I want you to analyze yourself and see where you are with God. And if you're not a born-again Christian, please, today, receive Christ as your Savior after the message. We're going to clarify something about what Christians, or people who call themselves Christians, should understand. You know, churches today are going crazy. It's more of a relaxed atmosphere, a casualness, if you will, towards God. More than a church service, worshiping God. I mean, the music has gone out of hand. I just don't get it. I really don't. We went to a church, and I just wanted to hear what it was about. Man, it was awful. Swaying and jumping around, screaming and hollering, and the preacher got up. He read out of some weird Bible. I think I called it NIV or something. That's what they call it, a Bible, but I don't, you know, I call it fire anymore. But they, anyway, they read out of that, and they went through these different things and all these little presentations of songs and all this. And then the preacher got up. He preached out of there probably about three or four words, and they closed the service. That's not church.
No.
That's not church. He closed the service without an altar call, without a time of anybody having the opportunity to come unto Christ. And folks, churches have got carried away with, I guess, a field of relaxed. You see it in their dress. You see it in their music. You see it in their attitude towards God. And there is a reason for that. Today we're going to talk a little bit about that. Now, I said dress, I did, and a lot of people's looking at me like, well, what do you think people are dressed like? Not shorts, okay? I believe that if you come to church in short shorts, you need to get saved. Amen?
Amen.
I really believe that. You know, we had a gentleman come to our church not long ago, and he had Speedo, or what, not Speedo, but elastic shorts, biker shorts on. Man, you shouldn't wear those things. I tell you, they're just too,
amen,
too graphic. Okay? We didn't say nothing to him, but he got saved. And let me show you what the Lord will do. He got saved, and he come back that night, and he had a collared shirt on and pants. Isn't that nice what the Holy Spirit done there? He had a conviction about it. But anyway, I see churches are going in that direction. It's more of a celebration time of life, I guess, here on earth. I don't know what they're doing, but a church needs to be a church. Amen? And that's
amen.
What Jesus is going to talk a little bit about, what's in your heart, when we reflect out of your heart into your church and your life. And you'll see a difference. All right. Chapter 25, verses 1 to 10 states this. And folks, I want you to listen real close because I've got some key words here that I'm going to pull out and I'm going to throw at you. And I want you to ponder on them until we get to the explanation of them. All right? It says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh. Go you out to meet him. Then here's one of the words. All those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, not so, this shall be not enough for us and for you. But go ye rather, another word, to them. Now what's that word in the Bible? Them. And sell and buy for yourselves. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. buy your salvation? Can you go to the church and say, I'm going to give $40,000 and I'm going to put new pews in here, or I'm going to get stained glass windows, or I'm going to do something, and God's going to look so favorable upon me because I gave this much money, and perhaps you'll let me get in the kingdom of heaven based on I contributed so much. So I'm going to buy my way to heaven. Can you do that? No. Doesn't matter how much you give. Doesn't matter if you give anything. Salvation is through Jesus Christ and no other measure and no other means. Now, we see what Jesus said. And what we have here is two foundations of those saying, I'm a Christian. Because the Bible said, all thought they were ready. All 10 went to meet the bridegroom. So every one of them tried to present themselves as ready. So we're seeing two foundations of those saying that I'm a Christian in the churches today. In the churches today. But we see here that Jesus points out, and this is scary, that less than half were ready, or about half, saying that out of 10 people, only 5 are really saved, are ready. And folks, that's alarming again. We look around here, and I hope again that every one of us is a born-again Christian in this room today. But there is a good possibility that somebody here today has some kind of confusement about salvation, of what it is. And some people may say here today, I hope I'm going to heaven. I hope I get in. I try to do my best, but it's not up to you either. It's only up to you when you make a prayer, confessing your sins, repenting of them, and receiving again to Jesus Christ. After that, it's God. Amen. So you can't say, I hope. If you said the prayer and you were sincere about it, you meant it, you should be a born-again Christian. You should be saved. You should be one that is a Christian. Now, if that's the case, I want you to hear me carefully. Carefully. If you're not sure about your salvation, listen. Now, with two foundations saying I'm a Christian, Jesus speaking to the church, and that group one, basically, is standing on a crumbling foundation. A crumbling foundation. Built on deception. The 5 foolish are standing on a foundation that is crumbling, built on deception. Showing at least, again, half of the people that think they're going to heaven, in realistic terms, are going to hell. And folks, believe today, hell doesn't exist.
Amen.
It's real and it's there. Amen. Now, a lot of churches don't want to include this no more. They don't want to include the blood of Jesus Christ. They want to eliminate these things. They want to make it a fun, exciting time to go to church and come home and go back the next time, do that, whatever. But church is where you should learn things. And hell is real. In fact, Jesus spoke about hell 54 times in the Bible. He spoke of heaven only 18. And if you read in Luke where Jesus talks about hell, he talks about it in a literal fire. A literal fire. And torments. I didn't say torment. He used an S on it, making it plural. Torments. There's a lot of things going on in hell that make you suffer. Now we see that Jesus authentizes that, yes, hell is real, so we should believe it. But half the people in churches are going to hell, even though they're in church, believing that they're going to heaven. Why is that? Partly because of the leadership of the churches, the preachers, the deacons, performing and not ministering. There's a big problem with that. And partly because some people have been deceived into their salvation, thinking they're going to heaven, but they're not. We're going to talk about these in just a minute. Now, these who are lost in churches, they feel that they're spiritually okay. Their eternity's fine, and they're going to go to heaven. But Jesus tells a parable so that they will know clearly and in all reality that at Christ's return, that they will not go. They will not go. Although they think they will. Hell is their home. Hell awaits them. Now, the Bible tells us in Romans 8, chapter 8, verses 15 and 16, you don't have to turn there, but you can mark it down, that we can know for sure that we are born again Christians.
Yes.
We don't need to wonder. If you're sitting here today wondering, am I saved? I hope I am. I'd like to think I am. You don't have to think that way. You don't. You can sit here today and say, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, I know that I know that I know I'm going to heaven when I die.
Right.
And folks, that is such peace that everything else in this world takes second place. Second place. To know, no matter what happens, God will receive you. No matter what happens. Now, Paul was real clear on it. A lot of people say, can anybody really know? Well, absolutely. But some have decided it's more convenient to not address it. To not address it. But to live with the status they're in right now. Address what could have been a deception that they are okay. In other words, if I just don't address it, maybe at the end God will weigh it out. Good things and I intent in my heart, what I was going to do and all this. He'll go ahead and let me in. No, he won't. No, he won't. Not according to verse 10. Folks, it's a reality check that Jesus is trying to put on us here. Something that we need to analyze and understand about ourselves. He's trying to make us think and realize there is a deception. That the devil can deceive you. And he will deceive you if you allow him to do it. Now, Jesus didn't say that you were a fool if you got it. He said you were foolish. Simply because we don't have to be foolish. We don't have to be. We choose to be. Some people ignore it and think that it's going to go away. And folks, that is foolish. It needs to be addressed, looked upon, and understood. Now, some keep living it. Every day they go to, or every Sunday they go to church. Every day they say, I'm a Christian. Keep living it. Deep inside, they don't feel it. They watch other people and they see other people who are truly born again Christians. And they watch them and they say, well, why ain't I got that? Why don't I feel that way? Why don't I ever weep like that? Why don't I ever pray like that? Why don't I, you know, go to the altar and pray for others like that? And they live it. They keep it. And they go on. Some, listen to this, feel like, yeah, I'm a Christian by what others have told me. Mm-hmm. Well, what others have told me. Well, I remember when I was 9 years old and Daddy said I need to go ahead and pray that prayer and I can go to heaven. When did I pray? I said, Jesus, sorry for my sins. I know you died for me on the cross. And I want to go to heaven. Save me. Oh, baby got saved. Yay! Good job, honey. Now you're a Christian. You're a Christian. You're born again. And that child no more understood what they were doing than the man or woman. You said I need to do it. I done it. I'm going to heaven. The rest of their lives, they're convinced they're going to heaven. Or maybe, like, I went to a church when I was young, about 15 years old, 16 years old. And it's a charismatic church. I mean, that's fundamental Baptist King James only, so I don't think I'm going to care about it. But I went there because I wasn't saved at the time. I went in there, and they said, if you'd like to pray, call on the Lord. And I was sitting in a pew, you know, just minding my own business, thinking, I'm going to get out of here. They get a little wild in here, okay? And I was sitting there, and a man came up behind me, patted me on the back, and said, brother, come on up here and pray. I said, okay. I thought maybe he just wanted me to walk up there with him or something. I don't know what he was wanting. Really, had no idea. Walked up there, he kind of pushed me down to the altar. And when I went down to the altar, you know, I was bowed like his. 30 mother men coming up there and women and everybody, laying their hands on him. Oh, praying, praying, praying. All of them started weeping. Brother, you got the Spirit. You're saved. No, I wasn't. I had no idea what they were talking about. Yet they thought I was a Christian now. And was telling me that I was a Christian now. And that happens, folks. Sometimes you might be on your husband. You might be on your wife. You might be on your mother, your son, your daughter. And say, look, you got to pray this prayer. You got to do this. You got to do this. It's urgent to do it. And they finally do it. And then you start treating them as a Christian. And some people start believing that they are a Christian. And they start living a Christian lifestyle. A Christian's life change. And suddenly, they're sitting in church for years and years and years and years on those pews. Believing. believe it, they're a Christian. But they have something inside of them that just isn't peaceful about their salvation. I don't have what that person has. I can't seem to enjoy the music like that person has. Or I can't seem to pray. I never weep, but I don't really feel like it. I just feel like it. And truly, if the Spirit of God does not dwell within you, you won't feel it.
Amen.
You're not supposed to feel it. And you won't understand it. You can't understand it. It's kind of like a sweet peach. You're not going to give me a sweet peach and take a good bite of it. Man, that's diarrhea. Bite another one. It's the best sweet peach I ever had in my life. Then I look at Kim while I'm eating my peach. I said, hey, Kim, how's that peach? I don't know. Now, until he takes a bite and enjoys it, he ain't going to know it. And that's what you're experiencing. You haven't received Jesus Christ as your Savior in all sincerity. You might be religious, but religious people go to hell every day. A question. Don't raise your hand. Don't speak out loud. Silently answer. Right now, do you have true peace on your salvation? Peace. Peace. No matter what happens in your life, you know you're born again Christian. No matter what happens, God will take care of you. God is there for you. It doesn't matter if you've got cancer. It doesn't matter if you're financially broke. It doesn't matter if your spouse left you or your children are acting up, doing things they shouldn't be doing, at the verge of, you know, killing themselves perhaps. You still have that peace inside, and I am a born-again Christian, and God will take care of these matters for me. I can trust Him. I can have faith in Him. Or do you grab hold of everything and say, well, I've got to fix this. I've got to do this. If you're truly a born-again Christian, God should be the first one you go to.
Amen.
And there's a spirit inside of you telling you, go to God with it. Go to God with it. Because He is your Abba Father. And what that means, literally, is you can call Him Daddy. He's that close to you.
Amen.
If you're a born-again Christian. And you have that peace, you know it. It's inside of you. In Jesus' great love, He came to secure our salvation. And once you're saved, you're saved.
Yeah.
He came to secure it. The Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. One reason for the Trinity, that's you, the plan of salvation. God didn't have to become the Trinity. He chose to for you. There's a reason. He came to secure our salvation. And then in His great wisdom, He warns us. Salvation. It's also something that Satan can confuse us about. And warns us of a false salvation. A false salvation. Jesus is talking about 10 people who thought they were okay. Who thought they were ready. Who thought they were going in with the bridegroom to the supper of the Lamb. They thought. And some were very sincere in their thoughts, but they still didn't have the peace. You see, when the bridegroom came back, they panicked a little bit, didn't they? Give us some pure oil. Give us some of that. We've got to have some. They panicked. And when the moment comes, you'll panic. Then verse 10 said, the door was shut. Now's the day of salvation. Now's the time of salvation. Not when it's too late. Too late. As Romans says, we can have assurance of our salvation. We can have assurance of our salvation. I didn't really understand this when I first got saved. Assurance of my salvation. I understood I was saved. I had peace about it. But then something happened just months after I got saved. I was at work and got a phone call. And the house that was just built, they just plugged the phones back when they had plugged the phones in the wall. I don't know if y'all remember that. You had an old cord come out, and the Bell South guy was there, and he was wiring it up. And that last wire he put on there, the phone rang and scared me. He jumped like that. oh, something's calling. And he picked up and said, so-and-so. And they said, is there a Marty Campo in the job? And he said, I don't know. There's a lot of contractors here. Hold on. Is there a Marty Campo here? I said, yeah, it's me. He said, well, somebody's calling. He said, I don't know how they got his number. They're calling. New house is out of the town that we live in. So I went over there, and it was somebody on the line, an operator, and she said, are you Marty Campbell? I said, yes. She said, this is so-and-so in the police department. I said, okay. She said, one of your children had a bad accident. Remember, I just got saved a few months ago, about 3 months ago. And I said, bad accident. We have our daughter, Kristen, we've got three children, and we got a son named Daniel. And I said, well, is it my daughter? Because she was like 2 or 3 years old. I figured, you know, maybe she fell down some steps or something. I wasn't sure what happened. And I said, no, it's not Kristen. I mean, it's your son. And I said, well, son, I said, well, he's 5 months old. What could happen? You know, an accident. What do you mean, an accident? And then a feeling hit me. And I said, is he dead? She said, yeah. And man, you're talking about rough. Folks, you don't ever want to lose a child.
Amen.
It's horrible.
Amen.
It's horrible. And so, weeping, got in the car, and I went to where my wife was. Had to be with her. Had to be with her. She had the experience because it was a privilege. And I had to be with her, you know why. And so when I got there, she was at her home. And back then we were very young, got married young, married 39 years now, but got married young and, you know, just had a little mobile home that we lived in. That's all we could afford. And I paid it off, you know, it's mine. But went in there and she was in there by herself crying. You know, so I said, Teresa, let's go down to Dad's house. I lived about a mile down the road. So I got her in the car and headed down there. Well, when we did, it was in the wintertime, it was December, about 3 or 4 days before Christmas. I turned the furnace back down. Back then, it was old gun furnaces. I'm talking about like 70s and 80s. It's old gun furnace. I cut it down and it malfunctioned. It started to feed fuel instead of cut it down. And it burned our home down. Everything in it. Now, boom, boom. And so, I got a little angry with God. I said, you know, the whole time, Lord, that I live in this world and didn't receive you as my Savior, it was fun. I had a good time. I was doing what I wanted to do, and I was looking forward to days where I could go out and just do whatever, live my life, and be free to do whatever I want to do in sin. But when I get saved, it seems like you're taking everything that I love from me. And Lord, I don't understand this. I don't get this. Are you a good God, or are you a mean God? Because I was newly saved. I hadn't been yet rehearsed in the Bible. I didn't know anything. Well, the next day was Christmas Eve. And I was still angry. And I went to bed that night. And I prayed. I said, Lord, if you got goodness in me, but I still had that peace that I was saved. I said, Lord, if you are a good God, do one thing for me. Don't let me wake up tomorrow. It's going to be the worst Christmas of my life. I don't want to experience it. I don't want to remember it. And I hope that I could go to bed that night and just dream something else besides my son in bed. My home was burnt down. We had no insurance, just a little mobile home. Didn't have nothing. And I was hoping I could dream about something. Maybe God would be nice and give me some dreams that I could escape that moment. But I just lay there and cried most of the night, silently. That's all I could do. And then about 6 a.m., a song come on the radio. My dad's bedroom, because they set their alarm to get up early, 6 o'clock, Christmas morning. And the song was one that you heard, but I'll never forget. It's hark now, hear the angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Man shall live forevermore because of Christmas Day. And when that verse come on there, it's like the Holy Spirit came into me and said, Daniel's alive. That's my son's name. He's fine. He's up here with me.
Amen.
But you got a job to do. You got a work to do. And that's when I knew God was actually calling me to be a preacher, even before I knew anything about the Bible. And I wasn't sure at that point. But it's like a bug that bit me. I got a fever or something. And all of a sudden, I got this feeling when that voice came to me and said, Daniel's fine, he's up here, and he's still working. And I couldn't hurt no more. And I couldn't be angry no more. And I couldn't be sad no more. It's like God put his arms around me and just started hugging me, would not let me go. Ladies and gentlemen, if I could take it out of a bottle, I would take it every day what God was doing just in those moments that morning. I wept with joy and peace. Feel good. My son was dead, my house is gone, I had no hope in those things. But I felt so much peace, and God said, this is me. He said, my God of love, he gave me so much I couldn't take it no more. And I was praying, and I said, God, let me go. Let me go. Just quit doing this. He said, not yet. And he hugged me a little time. Spiritually. He was hugging my soul. And he hugged, and he hugged. And finally, he let go. And I collapsed. I said, it's so good. I have not had that feeling since. 36 years ago, and I have not had that feeling since. But when I needed it, God was there and he gave it to me.
Amen.
And I know that I know that I know it's because I was a born-again Christian. And I know because I belong to God. And I know that God had special attention towards my need in that moment. And I've never forgotten it. In fact, the day of the funeral, we had family, and there was all kind of people, you know, because of the badness of the situation. There was a lot of people there. Lee Robinson was going to help preach the funeral, but he couldn't make it. So Jack Hudson, Lindsay Terry, and some others were there. Lindsay Terry sung the song, Little Jewels, and Jesus Loves Me, for his little funeral, and a little casket sitting up there. I sat on the front row. And I don't know, I could look at that little casket. Folks, you don't see one that big. Not with your baby. Little blue one, he's a boy. I sat there looking at that little casket, and I couldn't think of nothing. But Danny was in heaven, and I have family here today on the hill. And I asked Jack Hudson, I said, Pastor, I said, can I say something? I said, Brian, he said, yeah, I said, Marty, like, say something. So I came up there, and to this day, I have no idea what I said. I think the Spirit of God was leading me. And I spoke, and three members of my family got saved. All three were dead within 3 weeks. One was buried alive, and one was in a car accident. And that's the power of what God can do. When you're a born-again Christian, you know it. You have peace, and you have a desire to serve God and to go out and do God's will. It doesn't matter what the world's trying to do to you, how much it's trying to beat up on you, and how much people tell you that it's beating up on you. You have that peace and you know it. Do you have that peace today?
Amen.
Now, I'm going to go through it real quick. I'm going to try to hurry. I know you want to get out of here and eat. Hurry to you.
I'm good.
Verse 1 says, then shall the kingdom of heaven be like unto 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to be deprived. What does it say in here? All 10 were ready, right? All 10. Then it says in verse 2, all 5 of them were wise, and 5 were foolish. There was a deception here. Deception. Satan planted that deception, and 5 that were not saved thought they were okay. That's how powerful it is. You think about it. Then verse 3, it says, they that were foolish took their lamps, and with no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. What's the oil represent? The Holy Spirit. Read the Old Testament. Offer the Holy Spirit. Anoint with oil. The Holy Spirit comes on you and anoints you. Amen? As you're born again Christian. The oil represents the Holy Spirit. The lamps represent what? The vessels. The vessels, I mean, represent the person, you. Holy Spirit inside of you. In other words, it has to be inside of you if you are a born again Christian so that you go to heaven. Verse 5. It says, while the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. Tarried. He waited and waited to come back. Just like today, I'm ready for you. I wish it'd be today.
Amen.
But he's, in his infinite wisdom, is waiting. Amen. Somebody else is going to get saved. Somebody else is going to get saved. I'm for that. But what did they do while he tarried? Slumbered and slept. In other words, they become relaxed. They got used to their position. They didn't challenge it. I'm okay. Well, if I see Jesus is coming, I'll address it. I'm not getting out of my bed. They all slumber and sleep. They become relaxed with their position, their spiritual situation. Well, I'm probably saved. I'm not going to lie. Jesus is coming for sure. In 5 minutes, what would you be doing? if you're not a believer. You're probably getting saved. Amen? They all got relaxed. Verse 6. It says, in the midnight there was a cry made. Behold, the bridegroom cometh. You have to meet him. All, verse 7. Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. Class, let me ask you one more time. Second word, what is it? Huh?
Camel.
Y'all ain't shouting. Say it out loud.
All.
All. All those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. Now, verse 8. Let's read it. It says, and the foolish said unto the wise, give us your oil, for our lamps are gone out. Give us your oil, for our lamps are gone out. Let me tell you something about salvation. But you need to know, surely. No one. No one can share their salvation with you. We was talking about Billy Graham, Franklin Graham, remember? This morning, before Sunday school. Billy Graham told Franklin Graham, said, look, you got to do it on your own. Just because you're Billy Graham's son, don't mean you're going to heaven. Franklin realized he's going to hell if he don't get saved. And he got saved. Because Billy Graham told him, said up front, said, look, I ain't got to do me being Billy Graham. It's got to do with you in a relationship with Jesus Christ. God wants you personally, to see him and all that he is. And if you won't do that, you won't get saved.
Amen.
You understand what I mean, to see him? He wants you to see him. Now, verse 9, this is the one I'm trying to get to. Okay? So you need to really pay attention. Paying attention, look at me. Uh-oh, everybody ain't paying attention. Verse 9. It says, but the wise answered, saying, not so. This would be not enough for us. And you. Can't share it. But go ye rather to them, plural. Them that sell and buy for yourselves. Can't buy your salvation. So what is Jesus saying here? And who is them? Who is them that you go buy your salvation from? Did Jesus say something in a metaphorical way, or was he just trying to explain something and just kind of got the words messed up? No. Jesus never put a word in the Bible that didn't belong there.
Amen.
Them belongs there. He literally meant go to them and buy for yourselves. Well, if you can't buy salvation, who is them that you would buy it from if you could buy it? Them is what you would call a proposition. It directs action. Okay, some sort of action. Them means it directs some sort of action in you. But it's also a primary plural word, meaning more than one. Plural. More than one. Go to more than one and buy your salvation. Now this can get a little confusing. Who's them? Well, it's the same plural, or primary plural word, in the Greek language that explains the word one in 1 John 5:7. If you got your Bibles, turn it real quick. 1 John 5:7. Listen to it. Same plural word that describes, same meaning, both words, the word one. 1 John 5:7 says, for there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, which is Jesus, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are that word one. One. The same word as them that Jesus is using in the Greek language. Now, is Jesus then saying, go to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and buy your salvation? Yeah. That's what he's saying. But then you've got to look at the word buy. In the Greek language, this word buy is translated as barter. I give Ken this water. Ken gives me his tie. Nice tie, Ken. Thank you. I was born that water. Appreciate it, Ken. You see what I'm saying? Barter. This for that. Go to the Trinity. Barter for your salvation. What does that mean? How can you go to the Trinity and barter for your salvation? The Father gives his love and his willingness to forgive your sin. that you will forgive me. And I do believe that you do love me. Well, I realized that night, and right before Christmas, Christmas Eve night, I realized you do love me. You may not realize it in such a real way, but by faith, you say, God, I believe you love me. And you will forgive me. Water is for that. It is, you receive it. You accept it. The Spirit, He woos us. He brings us to salvation. And convicts us of our sin. We come by faith and repent of our sin before God. God, I confess my sin to you. While I can't remember every sin I've ever committed in my life, I can come to you without holding sin back from you and repent of it. That's what the Spirit does. So we repent. The water is this for that. I convict you, and I will be. I'll come, and I'll repent. And then the Son, the age of Christ on the cross, is beaten to a place unrecognizable as a human, the Bible says. You can even see him as a man, like roadkill or something, sit on the side of the road and beat so bad. Because our sin is a great price, David. It's a great price. Death. Death in a horrible, horrific way. And Jesus suffered that for us. He went to that cross. He was pinned to it. He was beaten before it. And he was taken down. He was laid in the tomb. But 3 days come. All of a sudden that stone is moved.
Amen.
And he walks out. Can you imagine the glory in that place?
Woo.
Woo.
Amen.
He walks out. He rose again. Paying your sin debt. Paying your sin price. It's paid in full. And now I give you the gift of receiving your sin paid in full. The part is, you take it, you receive it. I deserve it. It's just like you going to the electric chair. They strap you in. At the last minute, the man walks up there and says, boom, they pop that power to him. But in this case, he rose again. You know, we've been to the tomb. As soon as you walk out of it, you look to the left about 100 yards, and guess where Golgotha is? I imagine the minute Jesus walked out of there, he probably looked over at Golgotha and remembered the suffering and the pain. And then felt the victory. Receive it. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, then brings you salvation. The Trinity was created by God for you, no other reason. People say, I don't understand the Trinity. It's easy. I'm Marty Campo. I'm a pastor. I'm a father. Three different functions, right? I'm still Marty Campo. That's what God is. Real one. Brother, that's all it takes. I need to do it. And all sincerity. I promise you that's all it is. But there are some that's holding out. You're saying, I'll wait. I'll wait. A little more time. Let's read verse 10 again. It says, and while they went to buy, the bridegroom came. And they that were ready went in with them. Marriage. And the door was shut. You know what Jesus is saying here? The same thing that God done on the ark. Who shut the door on the ark? God. People screaming and beating on the side of that ark. Let us in, Noah! We got our children out here! Let us in! My wife, my mother's with me! He couldn't open it because God shut it. And Jesus said, and then the door was shut. You know, I love studying that word shut. Deep theological meaning behind it. You know what it means? The door was shut and locked. No one else is getting there. These are the words of the Bible. These are the words of Jesus Himself.
Amen.
They're not a religion. They're not this church. They're not my words. They're God's words. This is the simple plan of salvation. Once the door is shut, you don't get in. There's a time coming when Christ will return. And when Christ returns, the door will be shut. Yes, there'll be. I don't want to get too deep into all this because I don't know how some of y'all see it or feel about it. I'm just going to tell you what the Bible says. There are some that will probably come out of the rapture. Uh-oh. You know who they are? Read the book of Revelation. The Jews. Every prophecy from chapter 3 over is for the Jews. Old Testament. All the prophets come out of the Old Testament. See how the whole Bible makes sense? Today is the day of salvation. Are you sure that you're a born again Christian? Are you certain that you have received Christ as your Savior? If not, I beg you. I plead with you.